Okay, time to get started. There is a saying in Kenya, I don't know if anyone on our trip heard it, but Mary and I were very, I wouldn't say unceremonially told, that the saying in Kenya is that Americans have the watches, but Kenyans have the time. And it is time. We're going to use two mics. I will kind of MC the presentation, but if you want
one
to
thing.
Flag, tell you can finish it.
Okay.
See, even here, my wife will let me get my words in. But as we go through the pictures, I'm sure that our teammates are going to want to share certain things. So let's get started. Mama Jeremy?
People were asking about our outfits. A lady in the church, you will see a picture of her with Janice. She made all of our outfits. We went to her house for lunch the day that we were leaving to come back to America. And she brought out this big plastic bag. She started handing out dresses, shirts for the men, pants for the men, our head wraps. Over here on the railing is a wrap that she made especially for Miss Judy. Each one of us were just overwhelmed. She made each outfit and each shirt and each pair of pants on a treadle sewing machine. So.
There are a great many pictures here, so we will move very rapidly through some, and we will hesitate and talk about others. But I often made the expression here that God has a sense of humor, bringing Mary and I from Kenya to Ken Lee. But now we're going back, and we're going to take you on a... there we go. Courtesy of Matthew Grubb, this picture, but what carried us, what was the fuel in our tanks, were the prayers coming, going up from Kenley. I can sit down next to Mary here. But 16 pieces of luggage went, and not that many came back. But again, the prayers are what carried us, and they are so special to us. And we're just, again, counting heads. I was amazed over the 2 weeks how many times I counted to eight as we got on the van, as we got off the van. We have now reached Heathrow Airport in London, about to board 747 to go to Nairobi. We have arrived. You really can't see Audrey's eyes, but she's in need of sleep at that point.
I didn't sleep the whole
But there is a reunion with my brother Elias, something I hungered for. I heard some complaints about the food. I thought the food was fine. I ate the matumbo, the intestines. I had some. But here we are about to take on Nairobi the next morning. We bounce back and clean up good. Just milling around waiting for the van. Here are two tour guides, Sam on your left and Elias in the middle. Those two men went above and beyond scheduling and just setting things up for us. No, that is not our van. This is for Terry, who used to be a butcher, a hygienic butchery. Would you want a dirty butchery? But this is a typical street through Uduwala. This one is paved, most are not. But that is the church when we arrived there that day. You can see the first or the second floor going up, and they have plans to use the lower level for the youth, and then have church services on what we would call the second, they call the first floor. They also have a shamba or a garden or a plot of vegetables. They sell to the church people at a very discounted rate, and if any are left to the town people, communities people. This is the sign that caught my eye. If you read it, Baptist School, Udawala, baby class or child care through grade two. And I wondered, where is this? That's a great thing. I didn't realize that it was part of Udawala Baptist Church. Gives us a vision, a picture of the vision of the people of Udawala Baptist Church. As Pastor Allen's wife in the white and Timothy's, what's her name?
Catherine.
Timothy's wife, Kathy, in the green. They are the two teachers at the school at this moment. Just an inside view of the church. Of course, when we went to the school, they had to recite and do things for us. This is the first room we used as Udawala Baptist Church. Just give you a history of the church. The first meeting of the church was on February 7th, 2007. So in 3 years, it will be 10 years old. The first Resurrection Sunday, we had 100 people in that room. Some outside, but the pastor's count was 100 that morning. When I was home with the heart attack, they were forced to move. A Catholic group bought the facilities there, and they moved out to Airways High School, which you see has half a roof. The roof is mabate, or corrugated metal. And when a plane took off from Jomo Kenyatta Airport, the whole place just shook. And people from home would say, well, where are you located? I said, well, figure it this way. If there is a bad takeoff from Jomo Kenyatta Airport, the church is in trouble. But Pastor Smith from our church up north asked for their missions conference for a picture of the door of our church. I said, Pastor Smith, you have to understand, our church has no windows. Our church has no doors. So you could call it Open Door Baptist Church. But this is where God has brought us to today. And just to see the blessings that the Lord has brought is just phenomenal. That is not an OSHA-approved ladder, but each of the men climbed that ladder to get onto the roof, and there we are.
Preacher, can you imagine me climbing that ladder? Take a good look at that ladder. It was wired together.
There you go. But here is Pastor Allen, Terry, and myself talking to some school children. One of the homes that we went into, if you ladies remember who, or if you want to comment, feel free.
That was Nicholas.
Common is with the dust is, you leaving? Whenever you go into a Kenyan's house, they come around with a towel and warm water and soap so you can wash your hands. Okay, that's Terry and Jackie's bedroom at the hotel. We were blessed with the security of our hotel.
You see the Nairobi Java House. That is a place where you can get American-style food. However, you only see some of the people there. Our driver, Evans, he was watching out for Audrea and Tanya. So many times I would see him taking their hand or putting their arm around them, bringing them back into the fold, and that was one time when they had to be brought back. We did have coffee there. We did have lunch there. I think two times we had lunch at the Java House.
There's Audrey. We also had two days we set aside for what Kenyon would say to be a Watali. to be a tourist. And one of the trips was into the Nairobi National Park, which is a wildlife reserve right within city limits. And there you see a baboon. It's an important part to get a feel for the culture, to know where these people live, a water buffalo, some antelope, an ostrich, and some giraffe. These pictures are all mostly courtesy of Wesley and with Jennifer's camera. Thank you, Jennifer. Read the sign. Wilson Airport. I didn't know Wilson had an airport, but so I had to put that picture in. But again, just seeing the beauty of God's creation. If you look in the top of the tree, a little right to center, you see a monkey up there. Zebras, every zebra's stripes are unique in order to confuse the lions and the carnivores that try and catch them. Okay, here was the thrilling moment for someone. Terry?
These were armed men with machine guns. And then they're happy here, but they didn't have that look on their face when they approached us. And I think I heard Tanya in the back of the van say, "Step on it." And it was, for me, a little bit of a frightening moment at the beginning. I thought, oh, Lord, this is going to be it.
But the three men are rangers for the KWS, the Kenya Wildlife Service. There is obviously a poaching problem. So they are patrolling. And the guns they were carrying are AK-47s. Okay, somebody want to comment here? Oh. Okay, Janice. This is Janice getting her hair braided. Yes.
Which is wonderful. And she's got a different, she has it's like a restaurant. And she has a wonderful, she's just wonderful. But anyway, she sent these two ladies to do my hair. And they were very, very friendly. And their fingers, they look like, hold on a second. Their fingers look like they were doing this when she was braiding my hair. I mean, they didn't look like, you know, how we braid hair.
But that took approximately half the day.
Yeah.
One thing that you will amaze you is the furniture alongside the roads. I know Wesley was very impressed over the quality. And when Mary and I were there for 7 years, that's where our furniture came from. Didn't come from the stores, but it came from the people making it for a livelihood.
And this stuff was made right there on the street. That little tin or whatever you see back there, this stuff was not nailed together. It was not screwed together. It was pegged together. Like way back hundreds of years ago, the way our stuff was made, that's the way this furniture was made. So James and I was trying to get us a plane that would go back and get us a load of furniture.
But every night we would go to a Kenyan's home for dinner and for a time of prayer and sing a few songs. You can see the spread on the table. It was Thanksgiving every day.
The lady in the green shirt was the hostess that day. Her name is Milka, and she has some CDs that she gave us. She's trying to break into the music industry, and of course she can sing in the churches there, but she would like to get into America. So I don't know how that will work, but she's praying for that.
Very common to see bananas or plantains growing. This is the inside of one of the school rooms, one of the ladies' meetings. again, the sign there. It's just to know that they have that vision to reach their children was just such a blessing. There is the school building. They would like to build two more of those rooms. Each one would be about $1,000. And there's Terry misbehaving as usual. We put him in the corner. But that is a view out across where the Maasai have their manada, their village. This is the inside of Pastor Isaac's church. And there's one of the Maasai ladies and some of our ladies. Hey, I had to put that picture up. But here's one of the Maasai children. There is my dear brother, Elias. The Maasai will herd anything that has legs, cattle, goats, or sheep. They will go as far down into Tanzania looking for grazing. You can see the grass is so dry, and Pastor Isaac asked me to pray for rain, not realizing that God answers. Well, we should realize. But that is Pastor Isaac there with Terry and I. These are some of the Bibles that we were able to give to Pastor Isaac.
Might Wesley tell you about the trip to get the Bibles.
Before we got downtown that morning to get the Bibles, Mary had told me years ago when they first moved down that she had a necklace stolen, you know, sitting in the car. So I couldn't imagine, you know, how does this happen? We got down, well, we started getting downtown that morning, and the driver told us, Evans told us, he said, you need to put your camera down between your legs, under the seat, and roll up the windows. Well, you know, this van didn't have an air conditioner, you know, so we rolled the windows up for the simple reason. When we got downtown, the traffic was so close.
How was
it? I told Ari when I got back, I said the traffic was like this. And the people, you know, was like this. You know, you can't imagine. I mean, you could reach out and text a car beside of you. And then you could understand if you had the window down and you had a camera sitting up here and, you taking pictures, it was very easily for anybody to reach in the window and get it. And there's nothing you can do. You can't get the car door open. I mean, that's how close the cars are. And it was an experience just getting around in town. And I told Evans, I said, we got to carry, at that time there was nobody but the men, because we left the women with the group there that was having this meeting. And I said, we've got to carry the women back downtown. And they said, well, that probably ain't going to happen. But it did. So, Audrey, you tell them what the traffic looked like.
Mr. Terry, how was the traffic?
If I wasn't afraid of being lynched, I would have brought the video that I recorded of us on the way home one evening from town. He almost kissed a mirror of a bus that almost came in the window. There was nothing for, they didn't have traffic laws, guys. They didn't have stop signs and yield signs and lines in the road and pedestrian crossings. It was,
it was a suggestion.
There was nothing out of the ordinary for there to be 15 cars in line and our driver to literally put his nose in far enough to dare that car to move. And he would get in front of them. He would holler out the window, it's my turn. It's my turn to go. Oh, and then one time there was a wreck. We didn't know there was a wreck, like a couple of miles down the road. And we got stuck. We were just sitting there. The next thing you know, our driver literally is driving down this embankment, back up the other side. And he took us about 3 miles down the dirt path, like the shoulder of the road. He just drove us down the shoulder of the road for a couple of miles, doing 50. I mean, it was like this right here, the whole ride. they did not have traffic laws. And I'm like, do you know how many tickets you would get if you were in America driving like that? It was hilarious.
I got to tell you something about this church. When we were in this church, this is the poorest church I think we went to. They bought in a case of Cokes just for the eight of us to drink each to drink a Coke. And as we started to drink it, there would be 50 to 100 little boys sitting there just right up close for you to take that drink. And as I was there, I looked back and, you know, I got to know Brother Wes really good. You can't imagine how good I know Brother Wes, but he just started crying, got up, and he left. He couldn't stand it to see the situation. And then I took one more drink of my Coke, and no kidding, there was 100 children just sitting there. One little boy was right up here to my face, and I told my wife, I says, I can't drink this. Can I just give it to him? She said, don't do that. There's 100 of them. But what a special moment it was with these people. And it was just so special.
The Messiah Church is very special to Mary and I. The government came through and leveled the entire village, the school, and the church because it infringes on airport traffic and they claim security violation. But they leveled the church. The roof fell down in one piece. I should have put this picture in here. But the cross of Christ on the roof was still standing. And what a testimony that is to the people there. But again, this is the Messiah people. When we showed up, it was a market day. They brought all their bead work out. And there's a model there. But the more jewelry or the more bead work a woman has around her neck, the higher her position, her standing in the society or culture. Mary, tell them about this lady.
When we lived there, this lady, she's a Maasai lady, and she walked with wooden sticks. She must have had polio or something as a child, and she could not walk. And she had wooden sticks that she was using. Russ had these crutches at our house that he had used when he had problems with his feet. And of course, he didn't need them anymore. So we took them out there for her, and we, you know, said if she could use them, she was welcome to them. And that was when we lived there. We saw her that day, and she's still using those same crutches. And what a blessing it was to see her and getting around so well, because she has to walk everywhere. And as you can see, it's not a paved road. It's just a dirt area. This is Pastor Isaac's mother. He said she was very old. She was in her 60s. Well, I was feeling very young.
It's all relative.
I was feeling young at that point. The price of gas, petrol.
Petrol runs about $5 to $6 a gallon. Here is a vacation Bible school at Oodawalla Baptist Church. One of the local schools, the teachers actually brought the kids to vacation Bible school that day. Just a beautiful young lady, future musician. There's the educator keeping everyone in a line, and just leading songs. There's Woody. Woody got out of his box that day. Pastor Allen. It's a Sunday morning when I was delivering the message and Sam was interpreting. It's Mama Meg, the lady. She has been with us since day one.
This young man is Dixon. He lived right across the street from our first church, and him and his brother both came. They were the first ones there. This is me greeting my friend Susan. The first time I saw her, her husband Elias said I had 2 minutes to talk to her. This was at the church service. And this is Pastor. It's Terry with Elias at the church. This was something I did not know about that was happening. This is Sam in his graduation gown. He brought it to the hotel to show us. I did not know he was graduating from university that weekend. We helped Sam get through university, and it would have been our desire to go to see the ceremony. However, it was 6 hours away by bus for him to get there. They went to the main campus. He went to Nairobi campus, but the main campus was in Eldoret, so he brought his cap and gown to get pictures taken. These are some of the children outside. Do you want to tell about that, Mr. Wesley?
No, I don't think, I didn't know.
Oh, that's one of the things that stay in Kenya.
This is Ethel, or Ethel as we would call her, but over there it was Ethel. She came 6 hours one way to be with us the first week we were there because her first cousin is the pastor's wife. And she found out we were coming, so she came 6 hours and was with us throughout the first week. And on that Sunday at church, she was really upset because she was going to have to leave, and she stayed as long as she could to be with us. But Dad and I just kind of fell in love with her just because she was so friendly, so outgoing, and had taken her time, a vacation from her job, to be able to spend with the mission team.
These were some of the people that were on the education committee that I was telling you about earlier. And this just shows some of the food that we had. Every home that we went into had these huge spreads of food. They had like 2 tables full of food. Not only were we there, but the pastor and his wife and their children were there as well. And here's Woody's girlfriend. She came out. These are the children. This was a vacation Bible school craft that we had for the children, and they're all showing it off. One of the children had a birthday, and that's the birthday cake. In the middle are lollipops, and around the outside are cookies. They call them biscuits. And the cake was made by Susan in her oven at her cafe. This young man is Evans. When we first knew Evans, he was no bigger than one of our 3 to 5 year olds. And you can see he's as tall as my husband. Evans asked me personally if I would speak with him and his girlfriend. He's 23 years old now, and I guess he's serious about this young girl. So the day that we had the second meeting with the women, I went aside with Evans and I talked to him first for a long time, and then I talked to his girlfriend. And I think they are not ready to make a commitment for life friends, but they seem to want to date each other, bottom line.
Another one of our meals with one of the church families. I believe, if I have my information correct, this is the doctor's home. Yeah. Here's a men's meeting at a very important place, the Cho or the outhouse. But the church here, Kenley Missionary Baptist Church, was kind enough to sponsor a meal for the church this day. And some of these slides here are the kitchen facilities at the church. So all you cooks out there that enjoy your time in the kitchen, this will make you very thankful. There is the stove, called a Jiko, J-I-K-O. It's a charcoal-fired cast iron brazier, for lack of a better word. There is the chef. He's making Kenyan tacos or chapati. There is an OSHA-approved ladder. Sunday school in one of the classrooms. So Miss Janice doing some of the teaching that day. Here's the praise and worship team at Oodwalla Baptist Church. Many of them have been there from day one. I can pick out many of them. Some of them are new, and we're thankful for the new people as well. Miss Tanya, Sam and I again. A lot of light-skinned people in the congregation that Sunday morning. But again, we are so thankful for the facilities of Oodwalla Baptist Church. The people fully realize that the building is not the church. We, the people, are the church. But what a sign of permanence they have, that they can rely upon Oodwalla Baptist Church when the going gets tough. Just one of the church men and I talking. People were lining up for food, and there they go. Just a few candidates. Again, there's Timothy, his wife, Kathy?
Catherine.
His daughter, who was dedicated that Sunday morning, and his mother-in-law. Timothy has been with us since day one. He and Sam were my two translators. Miss Mama Meg. Then Terry handing out some awards to some of the church people that day. Tanya, you have an ID here?
That's Ethel, isn't it?
Oh, that's Ethel again, okay. Mama Jeremy, Sam, and I. Now we're going into the Kibera slum. During the 2007 presidential election, I believe it was, those tracks were torn right up. So all you railroad workers, that's how they do it in Kenya.
Pastor Bettina and her husband, Pastor
Bernard,
had two men walking with us through the slum area so no one would hurt us. They were kind of our guards. This shows one of the buildings. It's a mud hut, and it's got, like, I don't know what those things going across are.
Branches.
And they have metal roofs as well. We were at this school, and Sam is amazing with the children. All of a sudden, Sam says, Miss Jackie, it's time for you to tell a Bible story. Miss Jackie says, okay. So she got up and she told the Bible story. And then after that, we sang some songs and we saw their paperwork and what they were doing. And all of a sudden, he says, Mama Jeremy, time to pray. So I was the prayer warrior that day. And that, again, was in the slum area. You can see how they're sitting on their desks, two and three, four kids on a bench. And this was where they had their meals prepared for them. When we were first there, it was a very small kitchen, but now they have a much larger kitchen. This is another school in the slum area.
This ministry is directed by Pastor Bernard and his wife Bettina, a very dear couple to us. But they are fortunate enough to have some outside sponsors. This is in a Muslim, very heavily Muslim area where the refugees from Somalia and South Sudan settle in the Nairobi area. And if the children come to this school, the parents need to sign off that they understand that the children are going to be educated biblically. And they sign off, and the kids attend school. And then they get upset and they pull the kids out of school because they are learning about Jesus being the Messiah. The Muslim believed that Jesus was a prophet, but not the Messiah. So they pull the kids out. But then come a week or two or a month later, the kids are back because the parents realize the quality of the education here is so much better than any public schools. And just think about You see the lower left picture there, the girl with the burqa, the white towel or sheet around her head. What a wonderful way to reach the Muslims. And the ministry that Pastor Bernard and Bettina have, and we were fortunate enough to witness, and there's some more in that class. Here again are some of the Bibles that we were able to purchase and leave there. And that's through the generosity of one of the members of Kenley Missionary Baptist Church. Some of the children. Again, a kitchen. A meeting we were having with Bettina that day. And just a couple candid shots. Now we're up in Lemuru. Lemuru is north of Nairobi, about 2,000 feet. Higher elevation, 7,000 feet. And this is a school ministry, trying to jump rope. I put that picture in and I saw Terry there. It looks like Terry is trying to copy the answers off my paper. Not sure, but maybe. But even at that young age, they are taught, if you can read that there, it's in both English and Swahili. English on the right side, Swahili on the left. But here's a very, very dear lady we've known for years, and she is the cook there for the children. There's our world-famous ugali. Ugali is corn flour cooked till it coagulates. I call it Kenyan mashed potatoes because they all love it. Why are chefs mean? Because they beat the eggs and whip the cream. Too many cooks spoil the broth. But here is the lunchroom there. And here is the other campus of Lemuru Children's Center. They are fortunate again to have sponsors. A group from Mississippi comes over every year and paints and builds. But this is their kitchen, a very, from Kenyan standards, luxurious kitchen. All the goodies we talk, many of you people brought soccer balls in, Bibles, etc. Everything was laid out on a table, enumerated, and a receipt given to us to keep everything straight. Just some of the precious young orphans there. And there's Miss Tanya in the orphans section, for lack of a better word. They all do their own laundry and hang it out. This is Brackenhurst. Brackenhurst is where Mama Jeremy and I went when we first arrived for language school. Brackenhurst is or was a Southern Baptist ministry. To be blunt, they have kind of lost their interest in ministries. It's now more of a conference center and a resort. But we had many friends and we wanted to visit them. You see the beautiful plant life. And I thank Wesley for all these pictures. And there he is. Thank you, Wesley. But there is Pastor George, a dear friend of ours. He came out to say hello. Nelius, a dear friend of Mama Jeremy's. Lunch that day. Doesn't look like anybody went hungry. Sam, peace be with you. And, you know, we just a group shot under that banner. But the tea fields where many people are employed, it's a beautiful color of green. And if you are out in the tea fields, you get paid by the pound, but you're only to pick two leaves and a bud. And when you get back to the factory or the gathering area, they will weigh your bag, dump it out, make sure you're in fact picking quality goods. But, you know, it was just a chance to get some more shots. Candid shots on the way up into the Pastor Patero's ministry. First teen Kenya, 1903. The color green is just so beautiful. Here are the children at Pastor Patero's ministry where we went. Unfortunately, the evening before, Pastor Patero and his wife had an emergency at the hospital with one of their congregation members, so they were not able to cook for the children, and we did not learn about it in time that we could have reacted and provided food for them. But we did get to minister, and I think Miss Jackie was requested to teach another Bible story. That's Mama Deb there with the white blouse. That's Patero's husband. The housing provided by the Lever Brothers and Lipton T. This is Pastor Patero's church. I can't say enough good about Pastor Patero. He was the first church I got an opportunity to preach in was his church, and someone came to Christ that day. And the last church I had an opportunity to preach in Kenya before our return trip was also Patero's church, and someone else came to Christ. And there he is in the middle, and there are some more of the Bibles that we were able to give out. Okay, now we're Watili again. We got in the van. We're going up into the Rift Valley, which is about an hour and a half north of northwest of Kenya. Please don't jump, Audra. I don't want to explain it to Roger. But you can see how far down was. And here is someone making, you want to talk about that?
When we got over, you know, we were all trying to figure out what we could bring home. And I said, well, you know, Judy could use a rolling pin. She had one that was broken. So I asked the driver, I said, Evans, I said, is there anywhere I can get a rolling pin? Because all this stuff you see over here that we brought back, there's nothing on it that you see China on. Because everything that we brought back is handmade, and most of it is made right at the little shop that you buy the stuff at. And Evan said, well, yeah, you know, I think we can. So we went to this little gift shop, and they had a little rolling pin. I said, well, I was looking at something a little bigger. So Evans talked with the guy, and he said, well, we'll make you one. Come back here into the factory. Well, the factory was nothing but what you see. A shelter with a man sitting on a wooden stump doing his handwork. And he asked me, you know, he said, what color you want? It's out of rosewood. He said, what color you want? I said, well, I'd love to have some of both colors, you know, in the rolling pin. So he went outside, and I think we got a picture of where they actually cut this out of a stump. And this guy actually started working on it, and we left. I paid for it, and we left and went up to the lake. And when we come back and picked it up, but that's your rolling pin.
This was our boat ride on Lake Naivasha. Lake Naivasha is famous because they have hippos in the lake. And as we're going along, our driver is telling us a little bit, and all of a sudden they would hit the boat. And these hippos would come up out of the water. That's how we got to see all the hippos. And then they had flamingos. Usually you go to Florida or wherever and you see pink flamingos. Come with us to Kenya and you'll see white flamingos.
The pink comes from something that the flamingos eat. Naturally, they are white, but they will turn pink through the food that they ingest. Okay, now we get in trouble. We did some kissing while we were in Kenya, but we were kissing giraffes. I told the ladies that they could not get on the airplane to come home unless they kissed a giraffe. Some of them took the dare, some of them took a while, but eventually all the ladies did. A couple of the gentlemen chose not to. But this is, okay, there's Mama Jeremy.
You take a little piece of what we would call kibble, and you put it right on the edge of your lip, and then the giraffe comes and takes it, so it looks like you're kissing a giraffe.
My husband. Then I had to do it. If you dare someone else to do something, you have to be willing to do it.
But they come, like, right at you.
Russ, can you stop right there?
one thing he's not showing or telling you, we all kissed the giraffe once, but I think Russ enjoyed it a little bit too much. If he did it one time, he did it 20 times. And I think there's a little something funny about that, Russ. Sorry.
But, you know, we did have, as we shared earlier, we cried together, we prayed together, we laughed together, and we bonded so closely through all that. But then I did kiss my wife afterwards. So, you know, there's Audria. So, Roger, do you have evidence? Jackie? There you go, Terry. Tanya could not be left behind.
No, because Mr. Russ told us that to get on that plane, we had to kiss the giraffe. And before I left from Kindling, I was told I had to look after my daddy, make sure nothing happened to him. So I knew if I was able to get on the plane, he was able to come with me. So we got on the plane.
But after Audria kissed the giraffe and she came back down to where we were sitting, she says, "The tongue felt the same as a cow tongue." So how many cows have you kissed?
I'm not answering that for fear of incrimination.
There's Janice with her braids kissing the giraffe. This was our last night that we were at the hotel. They had a group from a Kikuyu group of women all dressed in their natural garb, and they were dancing and singing for us. And you could see the little girl in the white. That was one of the women's daughters. Well, they sang so long, and they danced so hard. No wonder they were all skinny as a rail. They brought Janice out to dance with them, and she really got into that, let me tell you. Then we have Terry and Jackie out there dancing with one of the waitresses from the hotel. And then the little girl just walked up to Terry and put her arms up for him to pick her up and carry her. And that was so strange because, you know, she didn't know us. This was the day we were getting ready to leave. Russ and I were talking to Sam. And their suitcases ready to get loaded on the van. This is Imelda. She is the woman that made all of our dresses and the men's shirts and the men's pants. This is a runner that she made. She made one for Janice and she made one for Miss Judy. And Miss Judy also got placemats. If you look at the piece that's on the table, she said, "Do you want edging on it?" And I thought edging means around the edge. She put all of this scroll work on by machine, and again, it's all treadle work. She's a wonderful lady. And there we are with her at her home. We had lunch there at her home. And she was putting the head wrap on me. I don't know that I'd wear it that way, but, you know, that was, and there's Janice again with Imelda. This was a daily vacation Bible school pack that was given to us from Kenley Missionary Baptist Church, and we were leaving it with the church in Utawala. I think we were working on a story that we were going to do. There was a lot of time that we had to prepare, but these were thank you cards that the women gave to us, thanking us for being there. I mean, talk about being humbled. We should have given them thank you cards, not the other way around, but it was so humbling. Each one of us women got a thank you card from the women in the church. This is Elias and Susan's home. We went there the evening meal before we were to leave to go to the airport. And here we are sitting around talking and eating and talking and eating and talking and eating. And here's the drivers waiting outside for us after they had talked and ate, and they're saying, okay, guys, come on, we got to get you to the airport. So they were waiting for us to get done.
Asante sana kila umtu. Thank you very much, everyone. You know, thank you for your prayers, your support, your encouragement along the way. And as I shared before we went, we're ambassadors of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. But at the same time, when we go out from Kenley Missionary Baptist Church, we're ambassadors from this church. And thank you so much for the opportunity that you gave, that you afforded us. And one last slide. Sure. Kenley to Kenya 2. There is a sign-up sheet if you want any information you think you might be interested, you're definitely interested, or you're just curious. Just put your contact information on the sheet.
Mr. Wesley saw something very interesting that while we were there and asked if we were coming back that way, you know, on our return trip. He wanted to take a picture. Mr. Wesley, what was that picture that you wanted?
First thing I saw was a Cummins or an Onan generator sitting on a construction site. Did we get a picture? But it was a trip of a lifetime, and I'd like to thank each and every one in this church for what they did to support us while we were going to prayers. I don't have any words for it. It was an experience that I will never forget. And I'm going to, if Judy can go with us on the Kenya number 2, I'm going to sign up. I would love to go.
Me too, thank you.
If you like it,
crown it.
That was their thing over there that Audria had to have a picture of. And now she'll tell you why.
Two reasons, and I never share with them the big reason. You want to be intimidated? This is the first thing we saw in English when we got there. To be in the ground, you have to be on the ground. And I had to ask somebody what that meant, because I'm like, are they going to put me in the ground while I'm here? Because I'm on the ground? But it's for drilling people, the companies that drill and mine for stuff. But if you like it, crown it. What would you think that would mean? It's a paint company. If you like something, you use Crown Paint to paint it. But to me, if you like it, crown it. Who's our king? Who wears the crown? Our Lord Jesus. So if you like it, crown it. And I'm going to say it all the time.
I walked away committed to really praying for that church. And it's been a pleasure to do that and just to be in that with them, knitted together in prayer.
I know this has been a long, drawn out, it's more probably far more exciting for us than for you guys because we actually lived it. But what a privilege to be able to share our days over there. And again, we could each talk for hours and hours and hours because I think we each have a little different perspective and you know, what really hit us the most. But we've been on many, many mission trips, and this was by far the best mission trip as far as seeing God at work and just seeing people's hearts so in tune to God. And like they said earlier about the children and the people, the one thing we said about the women, we noticed two things about the Kenyan women. They all have the most beautiful smiles and the most beautiful singing voices. And not one of us ladies on this team could sing a lick. So we were really in bad sorts there because even the pastor finally said, you guys really can't sing, can you? But we sang anyway from our heart. But anyway, we just thank you and we love you guys. And thank you so much for helping us get to Kenya. Thank you.
I just want to say one more thing. Every night, after we had our day at whatever we were doing, we would have devotions. And each one of us took a night to lead the devotions. I'm here to tell you that it was just amazing to hear each one of these people on this team praising God and just sharing a devotion from their heart and from their Bible. And God really blessed us as a team and blessed us immensely by the Kenyan people. And we thank you again for all of that.
Again, from my heart, I just want to thank everyone who had a part in our going, in prayer support for us while we're there and traveling back. I can assure you one thing as I close. I know how to count to eight. I would count to eight as they got on the van. I would count to eight as they got off the van. But just to be back here is good. Our hearts are in Kenya. It was bittersweet coming back, but we praise the Lord for the opportunity we had. And let me assure you, we were far more blessed than we blessed the Kenyan people. Thank you, Pastor.
Thank you, Russ. I'm going to ask y'all if y'all will go down and stand in front of your table around there, and we're so glad that you went. I've been on one overseas missions trip, and I know they've told me the same thing, that people say, well, why do you go over there? Well, there's two reasons, in a sense. It's for you, and it's for them, and they're tremendously blessed. You just can't believe that, like the lady who traveled 6 hours just to come see them. They cannot believe that people from America, that where they know we're blessed, would come to their country, to come to their place. Why would we do that? And it's a wonderful opportunity to say, because of Jesus, because of God. And then you just, it's like they said, they brought many things there. They gave them many things, but we gave out of our abundance. They give out of their lack. And when they give you, like they were talking about the Coca-Colas, it just humbles you, and it begins to make you realize how blessed we are. And I hope their going is going to help our church understand what missions giving is all about. We need to support missions in this church because they're on the front lines over there, as somebody was telling me the other day. They've got the Muslims right there in their doorway, and all they want is a chance to take over. And so the churches there are trying their best to stand up for Christ and to win their culture. And they need our help. They need our support. I'm going to close it today with let's stand on up and everyone grasp the hand of someone near you, and let's sing "Blessed Be the Tie That Binds." And we're going to close with that. Remember your care cards and put them at the back. And also, we've got the Salt and Light Council table out there. And be sure you vote, and be sure you get some literature about voting, or get on the internet and look it up yourself or whatever. Let's sing.
Blessed be.